Bertie's Escapade. It was 11 o'clock on a winter's night. The fields, the hedges, and the trees were white with snow. From over quarry woods floated the sound of church bells practicing for Christmas. In the paddock, the only black spot visible was Bertie's sty. And the only thing blacker than the sty was Bertie the pig, sitting in the front courtyard and yawning. In the windows of the big house, the lights were out, and the countryside was sunk in slumber.
"This is very dull," yawned Bertie. "Why shouldn't I do something?"
Bertie was a pig of action. Deeds, not grunts, was his motto. Retreating as far back as he could, he took a sharp run, gave a mighty jump, and cleared the railings round his sty.
"The rabbits shall come too," he said. "Do them good."
He went to the rabbit hutch and unfastened the door.
"Peter! Benji!" he called. "Wake up!"
"Whatever are you up to, Bertie?" said Peter sleepily.
"Hurry up!" said Bertie. "We are going carol singing. Bring Benji too."
Peter hopped out at once in great delight, but Benji grumbled and burrowed down in his straw, so they hauled him out by his ears. Cautiously they crept down the paddock, past the house and out at the front gate. Down the hill they went, took the turning by the pillar box, and arrived at the foot of Chalk Pit Hill. Then Benji came to a halt.
"Hang it all," he said. "I'm not going to slog all the way up that hill tonight for anyone."
"Then I'll bite you," said Bertie. "Choose which you please."
"It's all right, Bertie," said Peter. "We are none of us going to slog up that hill. I know a much easier way. You just follow me." He led them into the chalk pit until they stood at the foot of a cliff. Peter pulled out a large lump of chalk and disclosed the entrance to a long, dark little tunnel. "Come on," he said, and dived in. And the others followed. They felt their way along the tunnel for a considerable time in darkness and silence, till at last they saw a glimmer of light. The tunnel ended suddenly in a neat little lift, lit up with electric light, with a seat running round three sides of it. A mole was standing by the door.
"Come along there, please, if you're going up," called the mole sharply.
They hurried in and sat down. "Just in time," said Peter.
"Any more for the lift?"
cried the mole, looking down the tunnel. Then he stepped inside smartly, slammed the door, pulled the rope, and they shot upwards.
"Well, I never," gasped Bertie.
"Peter, you do know a thing or two.
The lift stopped with a jerk. The mole flung the door open, saying,
"Pass out quickly, please,"
and slammed it behind them. They found themselves standing on the fresh snow under the open, starlit sky. They turned round to ask the mole where they were, but the lift had vanished. Where it had been, there was a square patch of grass free from snow, and in the middle of the patch was a buttony white mushroom.
"Why, we're in Spring Lane," cried Bertie. "There's the well."
"And here's Mr. Stone's house, just in front of us," cried Peter.
"Splendid," said Bertie. "Now, we'll go right up to the house and sing our carols under the drawing room windows, and soon Mr. Stone will come out and praise us and pat our heads and say we're clever animals and ask us in, and that will mean supper in the dining room and champagne with it and a good time for everyone."
They hurried up the drive and planted themselves under the windows. Then Bertie said,
First, we'll give them Good King Wenceslas.
But I can't sing, said Benji.
Well, you must both do the best you can, said Bertie. Try and follow me. I'll sing very slowly.
Good King Wenceslas.
Peter followed him as best he could, singing a note or two behind, and Benji, who could not sing, imitated various musical instruments. He did his best, but he sounded terrible.
Benji, there's moon at night, the frost was cold.
Presently, they heard Mrs. Stone's voice saying, what on earth is that horrible caterwauling? And they heard Mr. Stone replying, it sounds like animals. Horrid little animals under the windows, squealing and grunting. I'll go out with a big stick and drive them away.
Stick? Oh, my, said Bertie.
Stick! Ow, ow, said Benji.
Then they heard Mrs. Stone again saying, oh, no, don't trouble to go out, dear. Go through the stable yard to the kennels and let loose all the dogs.
Dogs?
Oh, my, said Bertie.
Dogs! Ow, ow,
said Benji. They turned tail and ran for their lives. Peter had already started some 10 seconds previously. They saw him sprinting down the carriage drive ahead of them. Bertie ran and ran, and Benji ran and ran, while behind them, and coming nearer, they could hear plainly, Peter was the first to reach the mushroom. He flung himself on it and pressed it, and click, the little lift was there. The door was flung open, and the mole, stepping out, said sharply,
now then, hurry up, please, if you're going down. Any more for the lift?
Hurry up, indeed. There was no need to say that. They flung themselves on the seat, breathless and exhausted. The mole slammed the door, pulled the rope, and they sank downwards. Then the mole looked them over and grinned.
Had a pleasant evening?
He inquired. Bertie would not answer. He was too sulky. But Peter replied sarcastically,
oh, yes, first rate. My friend here's a popular carol singer. They make him welcome wherever he goes and give him the best of everything. Now don't you start pulling my leg, Peter, said Bertie, for I won't stand it. I've been a failure tonight, and I admit it, and I tell you what I will do to make up for it. You two come back to my sty, and I'll give you a first-rate supper, the best you ever had.
Oh, yes, first-rate cabbage stalks, said Benji. We know your suppers.
Not at all, said Bertie earnestly. On the contrary, there's a window in the big house that I can get in by at any time, and I know where the owner keeps his keys.
Put your trust in me, and you shall have cold chicken, pressed beef, jellies, trifle, and champagne, at least. Perhaps more, but that's the least you'll have.
Here the lift stopped with a jerk.
Tumble out, all of you, said the mole, flinging the door open. And look sharp, for it's closing time, and I'm going home.
No, you're not, old man, said Bertie affectionately. You're coming along to have supper with us.
The mole protested it was much too late, but in the end, they persuaded him. When they got back to the big house, the rabbits took the mole off to wash his hands and brush his hair, while Bertie disappeared cautiously round a corner of the house. In about 10 minutes, he appeared at the pigsty, staggering under the weight of 2 large baskets. One of them contained all the eatables he'd already mentioned, as well as apples, oranges, chocolates, and ginger beer. The supper was laid in the inner pigsty. They were all very hungry, naturally, and when everything was ready, they sat down and stuffed themselves, and drank, and told stories, and all talked at once. And when they had stuffed enough, they proposed toasts and drank healths.
The King!
Our host, Bertie!
Happy Christmas!
Then there were speeches and songs, and then more speeches and more songs, and it was 3 o'clock in the morning before the mole slipped through the railings round the pigsty and made his way back to his own home. Next morning, when the farmer and his wife went to call on the rabbits, they found a disgraceful state of things. The hutch was in a most untidy mess. Clothes flung about anyhow, and Peter and Benji were sprawled on the floor, fast asleep and snoring frightfully. They tried to wake them, but the rabbits only murmured something about,
jolly good fellows,
and fell asleep again.
Well, I never, said the farmer's wife.
When the farmer went to take Bertie his dinner, you cannot imagine the state he found the pigsty in. And Bertie, in the midst of it all, fast asleep. The farmer poked the pig with a stick and said, "Dinner, Bertie!" But even then he did not wake. He only grunted something that sounded like,
"God save King Wenceslas."
"Well," said the farmer, "of all the animals..."